Okay, Ronen Eldan.
Oh, thanks for the invitation. So, so the talk is about nonlinear large deviations and complexity of functions on the discrete cube. Let's start with a motivating example. So take the Erdős-Reni random graph, GNP. Is it okay if I write here? And let's define by T of G just the number of triangles. And then our question is, suppose that for an instance of GNP, I have twice the number of triangles than the expectation. The question is, A, what's the probability of this event? And B, one answer we already have, so let's forget about the first question. So the question is, typical instance usually look like? If we condition on this rare event, do we see just a GNP with more edges in it, which are kind of equally spread, or do we see clusters forming up, or, you know, what does those rare events look like? These are the... The answer to the first question is small.
So you think of P constant or?
Good. So for now, let's think of the dense regime. We will also think of P being a subconstant. Okay?
So if it's very sparse, like constant by n, then.
Yeah, if it's. If it's too sparse, so think about P as some 1 over some poly n, but not too large. 1 over root n, whatever. Okay? But I mean, this already applies to the dense regime. So one, find the asymptotics for the log of the probability that T of G is at least 1 plus delta times the expectation of T of G. Two, what does G look like conditioned on this event? So conditioned on the event E, where this is the event E. And a third question, which we'll see is related, has to do with so-called exponential random graphs. Suppose we take the probability measure over graphs induced by GNP, and we reweight the probabilities according to, so reweight the probability of GNP according to some e to the beta times T of G. So somehow we boost graphs with more triangles, or if beta is negative, with less triangles. The question is, what does a typical graph sampled from this distribution look like? And just to give you some intuition, for example, if beta is negative, then we want to have very few triangles. The intuition should say that the random graph should maybe look like some random bipartite graph or something like that. Okay? Good. So now let's talk a little bit. Oh, I see. This is not a very sophisticated mechanical apparatus. So let's talk a little bit about some general ideas in large deviations. So there's a very there is a pretty big theory for large deviations. What's interesting to us is, what's relevant to us is, let's do a very fast crash course on large deviations. By the way, if you take the words large deviations, you translate them to Hebrew, and then translate back to English, you probably get something like acute perversions, which makes this theory even more interesting. Okay, so if you do it again, you get large deviations again, I think. But it maybe it has to converge to some, I don't know. Anyway, so the main idea in most cases is the following. Let's look at the probability that T of G is bigger than some t. By Markov's inequality, we know that this is like the probability that e to the some theta times t of g is bigger than e to the theta t. So this is at most expectation of e to the theta t of g over e to the theta t, right? Now, somehow the idea that predominates all of the cases where large deviation principles make sense is that for nice random variables like t of g, we expect to have something like this. So, but okay, what do I want to say? So we expect to have that if I take the infimum over all theta of this ratio, then the exponential moment can basically reconstruct those probabilities with a pretty small error. Okay, so intuitively what this means is, when I look at this exponential moment, it's basically concentrated on one level set of T of G, which is determined by theta. Okay, so this is kind of the idea that predominates this theory. We'll not talk about this idea. I just want to mention this because this is a general way to reduce these questions to just the question of understanding exponential moments. Okay, so when we have equality or approximate equality here, the questions reduce to understanding the function log of this expectation. Okay? You can just think of it, it's not hard to see that this is some convex function. The probabilities we're interested in will just be the Legendre transform of this function. This is true whenever we have some kind of concentration that says that, you know, this infimum, and this expectation is just more or less equal to the probability to be bigger than t times e to the theta t. So somehow there's, when we get away from t, then either the probability really decreases or this thing really decreases.
Can you repeat okay. what you said about the Legendre transform?
Again, sorry?
Can you repeat what you said about the Legendre?
Yeah, so if you take the Legendre transform of this, okay, just take the log of both sides. okay? You take the Lejeune transform of this, so you see this is the infimum over theta of, this is exactly a Lejeune transform, okay? Good. So now, once we have this principle, large deviations become kind of a standard thing to calculate when T of G, or basically a general function, can be expressed as a linear function of independent things. For example, if T of G was not the number of triangles, but the number of edges in an Erdős Reni, then this exponential moment, you know, then we could write e to the t of g as e to the sum of independent things, and we could write it as an, then we could write the expectation as a product of expectations, blah, 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 and these things are very tractable. This is basically, you know, what Kramer understood in the 40s, and this is the framework for linear large deviations. The problem we have is, we have here is that, you know, T of G is nonlinear. I mean, it's a degree 3 polynomial of independent Bernoullis, right? The indicators of the edges are independent Bernoullis. And the question is, can we find some framework to calculate these things? Okay? So here, let's go to, maybe actually let's, before I go to the idea of how to do it, let me talk just very briefly about the history of this question, just to give some references. So the first work which understood how, which basically resolved what to do in the dense regime is by Chatterjee and Varadhan. They used the framework of graph limits to reduce the calculation of this to some kind of variational problem, which was then solved by Lubetzky and Zhao, probably 12 or something. So this kind of resolved this specific question, but only for the sparse regime. Graph limits only make sense. Regime. Graph limits only make sense there. And what I want to talk about now is a paper by Chatterjee and Dembo. From 2014, which basically introduced a machinery for calculating these things, which works up to the sparse regime, some basically polynomial dependence in the number of edges. And again, this, what you get is a variational problem that we'll see later on. And this variational problem was again solved by Lubetzky and Zhao in a different paper. Okay, so this is some of the history of this question, and sorry?
Concentration of the low degree polynomials like Kim and Wu or things like this, do they give?
I think they don't, but.
They don't give weak bounds. I'm asking if they give only weak bounds.
Wait. For these. Yeah, actually, yeah.
So there are concentration results for low degree polynomials, in particular on the graphs.
Sure. No. I mean, they don't give bounds which, you know, yeah. I mean, that we can use to say anything. okay. So here is the idea of Chatterjee and Dembo. So what they say is, look at the Gibbs variational principle What is the Gibbs variational principle? It's just a simple duality formula that follows from convexity that tells you that log of the expectation of e to the x, or actually log of the integral of e to the f d mu, suppose we have some measure space omega and mu with a probability measure, and we have some function f. It's always true that this is equal to the supremum over measures nu of the following thing, the integral of f d nu minus the relative entropy of nu with respect to mu, where the relative entropy is defined as the integral of log of d nu to d mu d nu. Okay, so this is this thing is well known. It has the proof is just three lines, and what it basically tells you is, you know, if I want to calculate this, I can optimize all over all measures. There is two terms that are kind of competing with each other, right? If I just take the uniform, if I just take the measure mu here, then I don't get a very high integral. But this will be small, and I somehow want to balance between getting too far away from mu and making, you know, f as big as I can. The optimal solution to this is taking d nu proportional to e to the f d mu. Okay, so this is what balances between these two things, and the fact that all other things are smaller is just the convexity of entropy. It's a three-line exercise. Okay, so then you can look at this and say, okay, great, maybe I'll try to calculate this. This will give me this. But well, it's not so easy to calculate this because the function f can be pretty complex, and I mean, how do you actually calculate these things? So the idea is the following. Hopefully, maybe for some functions f, or let's formulate it as a question, for which f can we take the supremum over measures nu, which are product measures.
So, in the sense that this would give something close to the
yes, one. Yes. So let's just, this works for a general, you know, probability measure space. Now let's look at the discrete cube. So, you know, we can, as we said, we can identify a graph with a point on the discrete cube, just the indicators of the edges. So now we have, actually, you guys are computer scientists, so let's make it 0 and not minus 1. Mu is the uniform measure. And what is a product measure? It's just measures which, you know, such that all of the edges are independent.
So then is the
answer 2
in the
connector, not the middle end? Yes. Sorry. And GNP is, there is a big N there. Yeah.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Are
you sure you're not just speaking for yourself?
No, okay.
And okay, so the supremum, and by supremum, as Avi correctly asked, I mean approximately, because we know that, you know, you can't have exact equality unless, okay, I didn't say that, but that's the only equality case. Okay? So intuitively, what does it mean if the supremum is attained over a product measure? Let's think of F as being the number of triangles. If indeed we can estimate the exponential moment by just taking some product measure, which is in some vague sense close to this thing, what it tells us that, in a sense, so think about, maybe a good example to think about is e to the minus beta, so e to the minus the number of triangles. If this approximation is true, it means that the density of this exponential graph is kind of a mixture of graphs G and P's, basically a mixture of independent graphs, meaning that I first choose some partition for my graph, maybe, and then I take a bipartite graph with respect to that partition, or an almost bipartite graph, but this I take with respect to a product measure. So I can decompose this density, which is not a product measure, to things which look kind of like product measures.
It
doesn't come from here. That's just the intuition. Maybe a simpler thing to think about first. If I take e to the plus t of g, maybe there is no partition, and maybe this supremum is attained just on giving some more probabilities to the edges. Okay, so basically it looks like a GNP, but with a different P.
If the approx weren't there and it was actually equal, then there wouldn't be any, then it would really
be right, possible. Right. If it was actually equal, right. So this would mean
approx.
Yes, exactly. Approx means I can recover most of the entropy of what I have here by kind of conditioning on an event under which I have independent edges. Okay, this is maybe a more accurate way to say it. All right, so Chatterjee and Dembo do find such a condition. Let me write it here. Ah, nice. It doesn't matter. I mean, everything is movable with enough strength. So what they do is they introduce a notion of complexity. For functions on the discrete cube, which is just, I'm not going to formally write what it is. I'm just going, if I want to really formulate their theorem, it'll take me basically the rest of this talk. But vaguely, what they say is that if the function has low complexity, meaning that the covering number of the image of the gradient of f let's say that Cn is 0, 1 to the n. So if the gradient can't be pointing in many directions, so I'm trying to cover this set by some epsilon times the Euclidean ball, or actually this is a the correct normalization, but forget that. This is just for your intuition. If the gradient is not pointing in many directions somehow, and you have some smoothness terms, so if you also know that you can extend f into the continuous cube such that the second derivatives are not too large. Okay, so if f locally looks more or less like a linear function, and also globally there is not too many gradients, then the approximation holds.
So this does not use in any way the symmetry effect.
Does not use the symmetry. I mean, the fact that this number is not too large, that does use the symmetry. Okay? And maybe let me talk about it for just a little bit. So what is the gradient of f? So we could, if A is the adjacency matrix of G, then F is really the trace of A to the 3, right? That's the number of triangles. And then the gradient of F is, you know, it's the basically A squared, or 3 times A squared, or whatever. And the question is, for all adjacency matrices A, what does the this family of matrices looks like? Can it basically span all of the directions in, you know, R to the? So I mean, just to be sure that, so A is an n by n matrix. So it's really in R to the n. And the question is, can this span all directions? And the reason that it cannot follows from Semeretti's lemma, if you want. So if we, at least in the dense regime, somehow if we know some global approximate structure of the graph, this dictates what this thing will look like. And there is not too many options by Semeretti's theorem. Let me not talk about it, because we actually have something better than this. So, I mean, I guess this is not a way to advertise your result, but somehow one of the disadvantages of their result is that once you, first of all, it takes a page to just formulate, and once you have it, checking these criteria is very involved. And you need, like, I don't know, 10 pages just to show that for the sample question. What I'm going to show you is a theorem that, first of all, does not need smoothness at all. It has a simpler notion of complexity. It's much easier to formulate. It gives more sharp results. And it needs just less than a page to kind of apply to this case. So but it's like completely inspired by what they do. So so you only need some notion of complexity, but you don't need any smoothness for that.
Would trace A cube be like the natural extension of trace A cube would be smooth?
Yes. I mean, it can definitely apply to this question. But what I want to convince you is that this approximation follows from a more general phenomenon, maybe. And there is a more natural notion of complexity, which kind of gives you more things. Okay? So Let me make some definitions before we formulate the theorem. So first of all, if you have some set K in Rn, and gamma is a standard Gaussian random vector, we define the mean width of K as the expectation of the supremum over points in K of x dot gamma. So this is called mean width because, I mean, it's not hard to see that gamma is, you know, invariant under rotations. So up to rescaling, this is almost like taking a derivative from the sphere. So this is like taking a random direction and looking how wide K is in random directions. Okay, so this is mean width. And now for a measure nu on the discrete cube, with density some e to the f, so suppose that d nu is some e to the f d, the uniform measure on the discrete cube, we define the complexity of the measure nu as just the mean width of the image of the gradient of f. Okay. Just so let's go back for a second to our number of triangles example. Let's normalize. So we have the adjacency matrix squared. In the dense regime, typical matrices A squared will have entries of size more or less n, right? In the dense regime, there is more or less n paths of two edges between each two vertices. Let's normalize A squared over n, just a normalization. Okay, let me write that here. So this is a matrix with entries of size between 0 and 1, right? And my question is, So let's look at over all possible adjacency matrices. We'll get some, you know, subset of Rn. And the question is, does this subset attain kind of all directions in Rn? Okay, can I, for example, if I have some sign pattern of like a matrix which is some sign pattern, okay, let's just suppose we generate a matrix with independent Gaussian entries, can I find the matrix A so that A squared over n will have a good correlation with these Gaussian entries? Okay.
F is defined in terms of nu. Okay. So F is like, okay.
Okay. F for us, F is just T of G. I mean, in our motivating example. But let's normalize it to be T of G over N. This is just a normalization. It doesn't really matter.
Is it T of G or theta times T of G for something?
Yes, it is theta times T of G, but let's just say T of G. Right, it's true.
It's important because the N, you only care for a special theta.
Yeah. But theta will be like constant order. You're absolutely right. I mean, if we just know one exponential moment, it doesn't help us. But I mean, different values of theta will give us essentially the same.
It could also help you to just work out with the critical theta.
Right.
If you just roll theta, you would do maybe more work, no?
Yeah, but I mean, it behaves somehow the same. So calculating for one theta and for all theta is basically the same.
So, one, if you want to
It's mean.
Mean, okay, good.
This is why I wanted to speak Hebrew. This is what happens when you have a non-native. Right. We can call it evil wit. Actually. Okay. So the intuition is so what my question was, take gamma, which is a matrix of independent entries, and how correlated can A squared over N, where A is some adjacency matrix, B with gamma. And the point is that, the main point is that A squared over N has to be positive definite. This matrix obeys the semicircle law, and it's basically a three-line proof to say, to see that those matrices cannot be too correlated with a typical gamma. You kind of lose a factor of root n when you check the mean width.
So it's also not critical to take Gaussian, I guess. If it's IID with some...
Yeah, that would be... I mean, as long as the entries are IID with, like, centered or whatever, you would have... But I mean, this is for this case. I mean, for the theorem, you do need Gaussian. Okay, so now we have the definitions, and let's try to formulate. Yeah?
So the fact that you work with GNP does not play a role here? So you go over all graphs in supremum, or?
Yes. You do have to go over all graphs. You can't just say, I can cut GNP on very low probabilities. Because you are looking at rare events, so somehow the ones which will play a role is the ones which are really pointing at the direction of intuitively. Yeah, something like that, exactly. I mean, it has to also go in the same direction, but it's not hard to make it point. In the same direction of an eigenvector of gamma.
Yes.
Okay, so one last definition before we formulate the theorem. So a tilt of our measure nu, t sub theta of nu, for some direction theta in Rn.
Theta is probably a different
Optation. Yeah. Do you have a better v? No, v is bad because this nu looks like v. Tu of nu, that's okay, is just the measure nu multiplied by some small exponential. I mean, small if u is small, but you should think of u as being small. So it's just the measure satisfying that the density is equal to d nu times e to the u times whatever point we're at. Okay, so this is just, and we normalize it to be a probability measure. So let's write proportional. Okay, so this is just taking a measure and tilting it towards a direction. Finally, I can tell you what the theorem is. So the theorem says, roughly, that for all mu, for all measure nu, sorry, there exists a theta, or sorry, I called it u, so there exists u, which is A small, and B, if I take this tilt, then this tilt looks like a product measure. And this happens when the measure has low complexity. The only thing you need is low complexity. So there exists u such that the infinity norm of u is less than epsilon. So this is also for all epsilon. and such that the Earth mover distance, which I'll define in a second, between the tilt of nu and some product measure, we'll call it xi, is bounded by, so there is this expression, it's the complexity of nu times n times, there is also log n, so let's absorb it into here, over epsilon. And what you should think of is that epsilon is some little o of 1. If we know that this is little o of n, then we can tilt the measure by little o of 1 in every direction. So we don't change the probabilities of the edges too much. We change them only one by epsilon. But after doing this, then suddenly you have some product measure such that its Earth mover distance is also little o of n. If this was little o of n, I can make this thing little o of n.
N is still the little n,
yes. So let's forget about graphs. This is true for functions on the discrete cube, okay? And three-line corollary of, does everyone know what Earth mover distance is? Should I write it? Or?
What? Learn minus one.
No, this is easier than minus one. Minus one I would define. So Earth mover with respect to Hamming distance, okay.
Okay.
W1 between row and row prime, let's define it dually because it's easier. It's the supremum over Lipschitz functions H. So this is Hamming metric. Lipschitz of the integral of h d rho minus d rho prime. Okay.
A lot of L from points of the Hamming cube. They are distributed into move this L to be distributed like mu prime. How much distance do the L has to travel?
I mean, I'm calling it Earth mover, not Wasserstein, because this is how you call it. Yeah. Right. Anyway, so a corollary of the theorem about, is that you do have this approximation for functions of low complexity, namely, you have that for all f, we have that the integral, EF d mu log of this, which is the supremum over all measures, blah, 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 it's equal to the supremum over xi, which are product measures of integral F d xi minus the relative entropy of xi, plus, it's upper bounded, also lower bounded. That's the hard thing. Plus something like this. So you have the complexity of f to the 1/3 times n to the 2/3. Times the Lipschitz constant of f, again to the 2/3 times log n or something like this. Oh, sorry, I don't know if you...
So mu here is any measure whatsoever on your space, or this is just for product measure like GN?
Ah, you mean the general, the mu. So mu is any product measure. I mean, I formulated it for the uniform measure. But I mean, there's also an analogous result for Gaussian space, but I don't. No. It's not arbitrary. Okay.
So, for example, it's probably just easy to see that all constant degree polynomials have this, or
not. No, that's good. I'm glad you asked this question. So the following polynomial, x1 times x2 plus x2, x3 until xn minus 1 xn. This has bad complexity. Because
four cycles is a very good example. Right?
I mean, four cycles? I haven't. No, that's fine, actually. Actually, every local structure, I mean, if just counting things that close themselves is fine. But this cannot be expressed as, you know, the trace of some small polynomial of the matrix.
Did you get the complexity to one third and to the two third?
So the point is, you have root 1 over root epsilon here and epsilon here. The corollary is just follows from this by a few lines. I want to tell you the idea of this, so I won't do it. But when you optimize over epsilon, you get this 1/3. That's...
Sorry, is the thing that if you have a low degree univariate polynomial and you apply it to the adjacency matrix and then take the trace...
Then that's fine. Yes. I hope I'm not confusing you, but I think it's always fine.
That's good.
Okay, so... So if you apply this to the triangles thing, it only works up to p is like n to the minus 1 over 36. The original Chatterjee-Dembo result gave minus 1 over 42. So it's not like, it's still believed to be up to 1 over root n or something. But, or I believe this is a big word. Sorry.
The factors that appear here are the reason why there's some limitation on
p. Yeah, basically. Right. But yeah, I'm not sure if a strategy like this can give you the optimal. I mean, the point of this is not to improve the dependence on p, but somehow to understand how kind of a general framework. I guess to get an optimal dependence on p, we'll have to understand g and p much better. It's not going to follow from some general machinery.
But the answer
probably
to your second question, whatever question is, that is yes, that if we condition on having more triangles than expected, then it's just g and p with tensor p.
Well, I mean, I didn't say that the product measure gives the same probability for all edges. So let me just, the product measure can have some cluster in it. And it's in no, maybe it's important to remark, it's in no means unique. For example, if you take e to the minus the triangles, then you should expect something that looks like bipartite, but you don't know how to make the partition. So really this, you know, what attains this supremum is by no means unique, but just think about it when, for example, in the bipartite case, choosing the partition corresponds to e to the big n choices, which is, you know, like e to the square root of n. So you only pay this thing in the entropy when you choose the partition, then this is, you know, this is little o of n. So you don't really see it when you just want to approximate this thing up to little o of n. Okay, this is the intuition of what's going on. Okay, I don't have much time, but let me like give you some very vague ideas of the proof, or very briefly explain some ideas. So the idea is to, you have the cube, and what you want is to continuously extend it into like the middle. And then let h of x, so now x lives in the continuous cube, be the harmonic extension of the function e to the f into minus 1, 1 to the n. What do I mean by harmonic extension? It's the unique function which identifies with e to the f on the corners, and it's harmonic everywhere. And by everywhere, I mean here inside, but also inside the facets. It's harmonic with respect to the facets. So for you guys, I guess it's much easier to say, take the Fourier expansion of e to the f on the discrete cube and just look at it as a polynomial taking real values. This will be exactly this thing, okay? And now, let's do the following thing. So let B sub t be a Brownian motion inside the discrete cube. I know you don't like Brownian motions, so just think of discrete Gaussian jumps. So I'm doing some random walk with discrete Gaussian jumps, but I want to keep it inside, so whenever I hit a facet, I just stop moving in that dimension. So let's say that dB tilde t is some matrix sigma t times dBt, where dBt, just think about it as this thing. And sigma t is a matrix, is a diagonal matrix with indicators of whatever dimensions I didn't hit the facet yet.
So you want okay. Randomly to some vertex of the cube.
Yeah, exactly. The next thing we want to do is we want to, so this gives me a measure on paths in the cube, and it's clear that every path will eventually converge to some corner. I'm going to reweight this measure.
And what's the starting distribution, the one you just constructed?
The starting distribution is what I just constructed. I take it and I reweight it according to e to the f at the final point. So reweight a path. I don't have more time, so I'm very vague here, I know. What's that?
You can take a little more.
A little more? So at time infinity, I'm definitely at a corner. I have some measure on paths. And now every path, I take its probability. And I say, okay, if e to the f was large at the endpoint, I give this path a bit more probability. Okay? And what it turns out that something very nice is happening. So you see, when I'm reweighting paths, it's not clear that I still have a Markov chain, because I'm reweighting every path according to something that happens in the future. So it's not clear if I can still write these jumps as some Markov chain. But what like miraculously happens is that equivalently, it turns out that an equivalent way to do this reweighting is just to define a process xt by just a slightly different equation. So it turns out that instead of reweighting every path, this is not a new thing. This is well known to people who do, optimization over stochastic processes and stochastic control processes and stuff. Anyway, this is equivalent to just saying at every point, instead of just making a Gaussian jump, I'm making a Gaussian jump, but I have a little bias towards where the gradient of H is pointing. This kind of, at least intuitively, it makes sense that I should, you know, do some kind of ascent, because in the end, if, you know, e to the f was bigger at the corner I arrived, I should have more probability. So this follows from something called Gersano formula. It's kind of standard. Let's not talk about it. This just happens.
It's the same as what happens in one of the proofs of the Weizmann Libnik
quality. Yes, yes. Exactly right. Right. So maybe I'll just say that, so it's one of the proofs of Brascamp-Lieb. So Borel used it for what you're saying. And there is a guy called Joseph Lehec, which kind of showed that these transforms give you like three-line proofs for many basic inequalities on like Gaussian space and stuff like that. Anyway. But this is the first application I know for something discrete, for the discrete cube. Anyway, okay. Now, it turns out that, yes?
The fact that you stick to the facets, the spectrums?
So basically what you do is you want any Markov chain that kind of samples from the uniform measure. You could do it many ways. I guess one way to do it was to move one coordinate and then move the second coordinate and then the third. But somehow this way seems to be like more canonical, and this actually works for us. But you could slow down as you're approaching the facets. This would also work for this proof, for example. Okay. Anyway, so now we know that X infinity has the distribution of nu. Okay? Now it turns out, okay, and this is just a calculation and it's standard and well known, this process VT, the drift process, is a martingale. The reason, I guess the intuitive reason to think about, okay, actually let me not. That's a fact. Hey. This process is really the entropy minimizing way to reweight this process so that I end up distributed according to nu. Okay?
And
yes. And the fact that it's entropy minimizing basically says that VT has to be a martingale. Because if it were not a martingale, then you know, I could kind of balance out what I have in the future and get less entropy. But okay, good. I'm glad this helped. Now, the fact that it's a martingale means that, you know, VT is the expectation of V infinity given everything that happened until time t. Ft, let's say, that's just the filtration corresponding to our process. Now, what is V infinity? V infinity, H was just, where did I write it? I don't know.
The top of the lower bowl.
So H is the harmonic extension of E to the F. And what is dH over H? dh over h is the gradient of log h. So at the corners, it's just the gradient of log f. So v infinity is just the gradient of log f at x infinity.
Log of e of f.
The gradient of f, gradient of log of e of f. Sorry, thank you. So it's the gradient of f. We know that this thing is, you know, the low complexity. This thing has small mean width. But the fact that vt can be expressed as, you know, a combination of these v infinities means that for every time t, vt is inside the convex hull of, you know, the gradient of f. OK, so we have some small set. Exactly. We have a small set such that, you know, the drift is always in the set. So exactly, we have a bound on how much the martingale is moving. And if you work out what's going on here, I mean, there is another crucial fact that I don't have time to mention. But what really happens is that this drift process Vt has to decide very quickly where it's going to point. It doesn't have many freedom to move around. And once it decided, then look, I mean, this if Vt was deterministic, this equation just tells you that you're doing a Gaussian jump plus a deterministic drift. This definitely ends up in a product measure, right? Because you're just, OK, just imagine the way to see it is if Vt is deterministic, then every coordinate is independent. Because for this process, every coordinate is independent. And if this is deterministic, then everything is independent. And you get a product measure. So what really happens is that very quickly, kind of, Vt decides on a direction if the complexity is small. And then you get a product measure. So this also shows that every measure, you can decompose it into some mixture of almost product measures. And OK. Let me just mention that we also have the more or less the same phenomenon in the Gaussian regime. I mean, it's not very, the ideas are not very different. Let me end here, finish here.